Yes, I'm still here, Hollywood. And coming up on today's episode...
There was another movie that you made that really had an impact on me called Making Love. You played gay in that movie. Do you remember people trying to discourage you? This was 1982.
I, perhaps with some actor's hubris, went into it thinking that I could get away with it. But it was a little early. It was still 10 years early, I think, for something like that. So it did have a major effect on my career. I didn't do another studio picture for 40 years. I did 80 for Brady 2 years ago with Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin, Sally Field, Rita Moreno, unbelievable cast. But that was the first time I was offered a movie by a studio since then. You're going to have to find somebody else to play Perseus, because I won't do that. And I went into my trailer and I said, I'm sorry. I'm going to cut her head off with a sword, or I'm not going to do the scene. And they freaked out. And the producers never talked to me again for 25 years. I wanted to raise a family. If I had been under contract to Warner Brothers and my career had gone the way they wanted it to go, I would have sort of been in the same world with Tom Cruise and all those actors that came up during that time that were under contract. I didn't want to have that hamster thing going on in my life, you know, which allowed me then to raise my kids, who are doing extremely well right now, and I think it's because I was there to put them to bed every night for, you know, their entire childhood.
Release the Kraken! It's a weird battle cry that has made a resurgence recently, but the first guy who fought the released Kraken went on to have an amazing career in acting, reality, and now in cooking and saucing. This is Still Here Hollywood. I'm Steve Kmetko. Join me with today's guest from Clash of the Titans, L.A. Law, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, and many more, Mr. Harry Hamlin. If you'd like to be more involved with us at Still Here Hollywood, you definitely can. Just visit patreon.com/stillhearehollywood. You can support us for as little as $3 a month. Then you can see who our upcoming guests will be and submit questions for them. You can even tell us what stars you want us to have on as guests. You'll also get exclusive behind-the-scenes info, pics, video, and more. Again, that's patreon.com/stillhearhollywood. Hi, Harry.
Hello.
Thanks for coming in to do our little program here, our little podcast. I appreciate it.
Well, my pleasure's all mine.
Thank you.
I've actually kind of been looking forward to it for the last week or so, because I see your compadres on the trail.
Yes. Jim gets out there all the time. I want to go back in history a little bit first. The first time I remember seeing you was Clash of the Titans. That was 1981, I believe. I was 18, probably a little old for the demographic you were aiming for, but I just remember what an impact it had on me. What was it like on that set? You had Laurence Olivier, Maggie Smith, Burgess Meredith, yourself.
Ursula Andress, who's the mother
Ursula
of my
Andress,
son.
Right.
Yeah. No, that was an amazing experience. It was a long time ago, and we were going after a slightly younger demographic, I think. In fact, I was asked to, well, there's a big story about the cutting of Medusa's head off that I'll get to in a minute, but it was a great experience. It was my third big project, I think. I had done a movie called Movie, before that with George C. Scott, and I had done a miniseries for NBC called Studs Lonegan, in which I played Studs Lonegan. And then I think Clash of Titans was the third thing that I did, yeah. And I had been offered also to do a movie called Tristan and Isolde at the same time with Richard Burton,
mm-hmm.
and Kate Mulgrew playing Isolde. I would play Tristan. And Kate and I actually worked on it for a while. And then came this offer to do this movie with Laurence Olivier. So like all of a sudden I had this dilemma. Do I want to meet Richard Burton or do I want to meet Laurence Olivier? Huge fans of both of them. You know, Olivier was kind of my North Star when it came to learning to be an actor. But Burton had inspired me because when I was 13, I saw the opening night of his Hamlet on Broadway. I guess it was 1964 it would have been. And it was just by a fluke that my mother and I got these tickets to opening night of his show. It was my first Shakespeare play. It was my first time ever seeing, you know, an actor of his stature on stage. And it was an amazing experience to see him. So he kind of inspired me in a way to think about becoming an actor. Not so much because of his performance in Hamlet, but because afterwards my mother said, "Listen, what we need to do now is go backstage and see if we can catch a glimpse of the star coming out of the stage door." And so we walked around the back of the theater, and sure enough, there was a crowd of people waiting to see Burton come out. And it was in an alley. Maybe it was the Schubert Alley. But I remember standing there in this gaggle of people and then seeing a huge black limousine driving down the alley toward the stage door. And just as the limousine got in front of the door to the limousine opened, the stage door opened, and out swept Richard Burton, throwing his scarf over his shoulder as he swept into the car. And in the car was Elizabeth Taylor, surrounded by about 50 long-stem red roses. And he got in the car, they embraced, the door closed, and I said, "That's what I want."
The roses are Elizabeth Taylor.
I wanted the whole nine yards. The car, the roses, the pretty girl. And, you know, I was very fortunate to get that. That was not my main motivation, ultimately, for becoming an actor. But it was kind of it gave me a nudge, put it that way.
Do you believe that seeing someone on stage is a real jolt? Can be a real jolt?
Without question. I mean, when I played Hamlet, I stole so much from his performance. I had remembered. I played it when I was 30-something, 31, or maybe it was 30. And I had remembered bits and pieces of his performance that I put into mine. Most notably, there's a moment in the play when he says something like, "If you find him not within the next month, you will nose him as you make your way to the up the stairs to the foyer," something along those lines, meaning that Polonius is dead, he's stuffed him in a corner under the stairs, and you'll smell him, you know, within the next month. But the way he did it and the way he said it, putting his finger to his nose, caused the audience to go into uproarious laughter. Now, we're watching this huge tragedy, right? Hamlet, the greatest tragedy of all time. And yet, he kept the audience laughing the whole time. So I ended up stealing that aspect of his performance. And so the reviews that came out for me, each one of them talked about how it kept the audience in stitches throughout the play as well. So
mission kind of accomplished.
Yeah, absolutely. But Clash of the Titans was an extraordinary experience for a young kid to go to Europe and film all over Europe with the likes of Laurence Olivier and Burgess Meredith, with whom I spent most of the time. It was an amazing time.
Did you learn anything from Laurence Olivier?
I did.
That might be a dumb question.
No, of course. I mean, put it this way. So the very first day on the set, I was not working with him. I was watching him at the studio in Pinewood. And this thing called lasers had just been invented. And there was this laser behind him. He was playing Zeus. And they had to get the laser just right and the smoke with the laser just right in order to make the scene work. And this took a long, long time because no one had ever worked with a laser before. And finally, they got to the moment when he could say his lines. And he forgot his lines. And he looked at it and he goes, "Oh, fuck it. I forgot my fucking line. And what's the line?" You know. And then to hear Olivier, you know, have a very human response to actually, you know, what we all go through, because we all, you know, at one point or another forget our lines, you know. But to hear him respond that way, just kind of, it made me feel like, okay, this is going to be fun. This is going to be a great experience. I was not intimidated after that. But then his 70th birthday took place while we were on the set. And I gave him a copy of Pachelbel's Canon in D major. I don't know if you know that piece
of
music.
No, I don't.
If you heard it, you would recognize it now, but it was just being discovered or rediscovered during the 70s. Now it's played at every wedding. Most people know the tune, and I'm sure you do, but you just don't know what it's called. But he had never heard it before, and he wrote me the most beautiful letter thanking me and kind of apologizing for being in that movie, knowing how much I revered him in his career. He also knew kind of how stupid that movie was from the perspective of a great, great stage and film actor. And he kind of said, I'm sorry we're meeting under such circumstances, my boy, but I have so many mouths to feed. I have to work in things like this. And so he was kind of denigrating the film that I was the star of. But, you know, at the same time, I was grateful that he had responded at all. But I did ask him once for some advice about acting. I thought, you know, here's this great, great actor. I was having dinner somewhere and he was there, and I cornered him and I said, so if you were to pass something along to a young actor like me, aside from, you know, never give up and, you know, always be nice to everybody on your way up, which were also things that he had talked to me about. He said, listen, he said, I was once doing a film called The Entertainer, and he said, I couldn't find my character. And he said, it wasn't until someone from the property department handed him a green umbrella. And when he took the green umbrella, somehow that helped him understand who his character was. And he said, always look out for things like that. If you're trying to find and develop a character, there may be something that just kind of helps you to dive into the character. And so I always do that. I've always done that since. And it actually helped with the character that I'm playing right now on Mayfair Witches, but we can get to that later.
What about Maggie Smith, working with her?
Oh, my God, what a stitch. I mean, when we were, we would go to lunch at the studio in Pinewood, and there would be a long table, maybe 10 or so of us from the cast. All those big actors were there, you know, Claire Bloom and Maggie Smith, Ursula was there. Sean Phillips was there, and she would just keep us in just tears of laughter the entire time. One of the funniest human beings I have ever encountered in my life.
Do you do an impression of her?
No,
I don't. So many people do.
I would never even try to do an impression of her.
There was another movie that you made that really had an impact on me called Making Love. You played gay in that movie. Do you remember people trying to discourage you? This was 1982.
Well, we shot it in 80 or 81. I mean, that role had been offered to everybody in Hollywood, and everyone had turned it down because they felt that it would hurt their career to play somebody gay. There were a lot of people who said I shouldn't go near that. My agent was not one of them. He said at the time that I was the one person in town because of my relationship with Ursula, which was all over the tabloids, that, you know, people knew that I was straight and I could get away with doing this. But for me, none of that made any difference. For me, I read the script, and the first script that I read was much edgier than the script that ended up being shot. And that's what I liked about it. They kind of whitewashed it a little bit along the way, thinking that it would be... the edginess of it would turn the audience off, I guess. They sanitized it at the studio. But I had been offered a lot of really stupid movies at that point. And I was on the list for every movie in town. So I was going out and meeting all the big directors and reading all the big scripts that were going on, because I'd been nominated for a Golden Globe for Movie, the first movie I had done. And Warner Brothers had offered me a huge contract, which I turned down. But I had been approached by pretty much everybody for every movie that was going on. The ones that I was being offered were really stupid. They were movies about vampire bats invading small towns, cloaked in the idea that they were actually inspiring people to support Native Americans, when in fact the movie was really about vampire bats or rogue bats. Anyway, those kind of movies I was being offered. So I read this script and I said, well, you know, this is about something that's actually going on in the world that nobody wants to talk about. It's a real subject that's real in society. It's something that needs to be discussed, and we need to start a conversation about this. And so I, perhaps with some actor's hubris, went into it thinking that I could get away with it. But it was a little early. It was still 10 years early, I think, for something like that. So it did have a major effect on my career.
How so?
Well, I never, I didn't do another studio picture for 40 years. So I did 80 for Brady 2 years ago with Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin, Sally Field, Rita Moreno, unbelievable cast. But that was the first time I was offered a movie by a studio since then.
So, really?
Yeah, it completely changed my career.
It really impacted my life, as it turns out, as a gay man who was divorcing his wife at that time.
Uh-huh, interesting.
That movie tore me to shreds.
I'll bet, yeah.
I was had to compose myself before leaving for a while.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And I think it was, even though it had a difficult storyline, I think it was really life-affirming for a lot of gay people.
Without question. Now, to this day, Steve, not a week goes by when someone doesn't come up to me and say, God, thank you for making that film. It changed my life, or it helped me talk to my parents about my sexuality or whatever. But I, wherever I go to this day, and I'm extraordinarily proud of that. I mean, yeah, it didn't have the greatest effect on my career, feature film career, but it did have, on the other side of that equation, it had a great, great positive effect on a huge community.
Thank you. I'd like to talk, I know you have a lot of things to talk about. You're such a busy man. Tell me about the cooking show.
AMC came to me 2 years ago and said they wanted me to do a cooking show. And I was like, what? Why would you want me to do a cooking show? Yeah, I cook for my kids and I cook for Lisa, but you know, I'm not a chef and I'm not really even a cook. I mean, if I cook, I'm a small C cook, you know? And they said, yeah, well, but everybody thinks of you as a cook because of that show. And I guess it was one of the executives' wives at AMC had seen the Real Housewives show and had seen me cooking the bolognese for the girls and had seen their reaction to it, which was very positive. And somehow that morphed into me having a cooking show on their network. And I said to them, that's insane to begin with. But I said, if you really want me to do it, I have one condition. And that is that my niece, who is a certified chef, cordon bleu trained executive chef, who had helped establish Le Pain Quotidien, which is a big chain in the United States, and another chain called Prêt-à-Manger. She was at the beginning of that as well. And she had worked for Google, running their entire food operation for years, and responsible for 60,000 meals a day. I said, if you let me have her in the kitchen with me, because she knows what the fuck she's doing, then I'll consider doing it. And they said, okay, so what could I do? I had to do it. And now we've been picked up for season two. We start shooting that in 1 month exactly.
And you have a tomato sauce that's catching on everywhere.
Yeah, well, that's true. harrysfamous.com. That's where you can get it now. But hopefully it'll be available all over the place within the next year.
Didn't Cindy Crawford and Randy Gerber tout it on their Instagram account?
They did, yes. Cindy, I gave a bottle to Cindy a couple weeks ago, and she served it to Randy, and they loved it. So, yeah, I mean, she helped a lot to get the word out, for sure.
Had you ever foreseen anything like this early on in your career?
No.
Ending up doing this? No.
Absolutely not. That cooking show, no.
It's kind of neat, though.
Well, I mean, look, I'm going along with it. I'll go along with it because, you know, it's fun, and I'm learning a lot about cooking from my niece, you know, so why not?
And because you're a Renaissance man.
Well, I'm not sure about that.
Who knows? You've done a little bit of everything.
Well, I do. I'm curious. So that curiosity leads me down a lot of rabbit holes.
Yep. It was in, backtracking a minute, in Clash of the Titans that we all became familiar with the Kraken. And it was part of a political campaign a couple of years ago. Are you surprised by that? You actually came face to face with the Kraken.
And defeated the Kraken.
Yes.
With the help of Medusa's head. You know, the zeitgeist is mercurial, and somehow it latched onto the idea of the Kraken, and yeah, it did find its way into the political discussion a couple of years ago. But yeah, whenever I hear that, I just go, oh, that's interesting, and then move on. But But yeah, there's a story about the Kraken and Medusa that's kind of interesting too for Clash of the Titans wise. They came to me the day that we were going to shoot the scene where I cut off her head. We were in Malta, and we were shooting in an abandoned warehouse where they'd converted it into the set of her lair. And I was in my trailer at about 7 o'clock in the morning that morning, and somebody knocked on the door and said, "Excuse me, but we got a telex from London last night. You can no longer cut her head off with the sword." I said, what? And they said, yeah, they've determined that it would get an X rating for violence with teenagers in England if you're holding the sword that actually cuts her head off. And I tried to imagine that, and then I tried to imagine, well, how am I going to get her head then? And they said, well, we've got it all figured out. You're going to take your shield and throw it like a frisbee against the wall. It's going to bounce off the wall and inadvertently cut her head off, and then you're going to grab her head and you'll have it. And I imagined that for a moment, and I said, well, in that case, you're going to have to find somebody else to play Perseus, because I won't do that. And I went into my trailer and I said, I'm sorry, I'm going to cut her head off with a sword, or I'm not going to do the scene. And they freaked out, and we were somewhere way outside of Valletta, which is the capital of Malta, and of course there were no cell phones in those days, and they had this recalcitrant actor who was about to quit the movie, and I said, I will quit the movie. I will go home tonight to L.A. if you insist on me doing this, because I'm not going to do it. And man, they freaked out. I was in the trailer. They unplugged the electricity from the trailer, so that it was a really hot day in the summer in Malta, and they tried to kind of smoke me out. Get me to come out, and they kept sending people into the trailer to get me to come out. They sent in the first AD, and then they sent in the cinematographer, and they sent in all these different people from the crew. And every time somebody came in, they came out on my side, because I said, you guys, the myth is that he cuts her head off with the sword given to him by Zeus. Why the fuck do I have the sword if I don't use it to cut her head off? You know, and so by the end of the day, 4 p.m. or so, they gave in. And they said, okay, well, we don't want to lose the day, and we'll take our chances with the X rating. And of course, it didn't get an X rating for violence. And if you could imagine that scene being that way in the film, it would have tanked. The movie would have been a total, would have been a disaster. So even though they never thanked me for making that decision, they ought to have. They never talked to me again the producers never talked to me again for 25 years. After 25 years, Ray Harryhausen did call me up and ask me to join him on stage for a presentation in Hollywood when he was coming in, but it took 25 years because they were so upset with me.
Don't take it personally.
I didn't. Please, I certainly didn't. They didn't like the fact that, I fought with them the whole time, the entire time we shot. They just wanted to make money. They wanted to shoot it fast and furious, and I said, well, wait, you know, there's ways to make this movie actually better than what's on the page, and I would insist on doing certain things a certain way. And they thought it was, they thought I should be doing whatever they said, put it that way.
How long has your career been going now?
On stage or on, if you add the whole thing up?
Add the whole thing up.
Well, yeah, so my first paycheck as a professional actor was for $126 a week. In 1976, when I played the boy in Equus. And if you know that play, you know that it's a double-edged sword, that it's a great, great, great award-winning part, but the other side of that equation is he's got to be 100% naked on stage for the last 20 minutes of the play. So it was kind of like, oh, okay, this is great, but on the other hand, what am I getting myself into here, you know? And fortunately, it worked out. It was, the director didn't want us to take our clothes off until opening night. So I was on opening night in front of an audience of 1,500 people, wondering what was going to happen as I looked down at this girl who was completely naked with her legs spread, wanting me to come down and have her, which I couldn't do, which is one of the premises of the play. But I didn't know what was going to happen because I had never done it before. But fortunately, it worked out.
So that was in what?
1976.
So 34, 58 years ago. How have you managed to keep as busy as you have? The stories about Hollywood is it's hard to start a career. I think it's even harder to keep it going to the degree that you have.
Well, I mean, I have exactly the kind of career that I want. I mean, the amount of fame, the exact amount of opportunity. Because I turned down this contract with Warner Bros., which was, they called that contract the Clint, because it was the same contract that had been offered to Clint Eastwood. And he's still under contract there, you know. But it was a three-picture deal with a lot of options and all of that. We negotiated the contract all the way up to the moment of the signing, and I actually went to the head of the studio's office to sign the contract, and I walked into this office, and there's all these pictures of movie stars around on the walls. It was one of those oak-walled offices, and the head of the studio was a guy named Robert Shapiro, and all these suits were in the room, and I had this weird feeling at the moment that I was about to put the pen to the paper. I thought to myself, you know, what am I doing? If I sign this piece of paper, I'm not going to be free anymore. I'm going to be beholden to this studio, possibly for the rest of my life. Yeah, I said, maybe, you know, I'll have a great film career. I could become a big movie star or whatever. But I just couldn't imagine not being free being a free agent. And there were a whole lot of things going around in my head at that moment. And I finally just had made the snap decision not to sign the contract. And when I put the pen down and walked out of the room, I mean, their mouths dropped open. It was like, what? What is this kid doing? You know, we've just offered him like the brass ring, right? But I made that decision, and I think it was the right decision, because I've been able to have this long career, like you said, and I credit that to the fact that I spent like 7 years studying. I mean, I went to acting school and I became classically trained, and all. I think that has a lot to do with the longevity of a career. And I knew that going in. I thought, you know, this acting thing is going to be really mercurial. You never know whether you're going to make it or not, and if you do make it, you never know where you're going to keep it. Blah, 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 all this stuff. So I thought, this is before I went into acting school. I thought, you know, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it right. I'm going to learn the craft. So I attribute a lot of the longevity to that. But also, you know, the fact that I didn't sign the contract with Warner Bros., the fact that I remained a free agent, allowed me to do just what I wanted to do instead of having somebody tell me what to do. And I think that has had a lot to do with it as well. And I wanted to raise a family. If I had been under contract to Warner Brothers and my career had gone the way they wanted it to go, I would have sort of been in the same world with Tom Cruise and all those actors that came up during that time that were under contract. And they would have wanted me to do movie after movie. And of course, you're like a snake that is eating its own tail when you're a big movie star like that, because each movie has to be bigger than the last one, and if it's not, you're in trouble. And so I didn't want to have that hamster thing going on in my life, you know, which allowed me then to raise my kids, who are doing extremely well right now, and I think it's because I was there to put them to bed every night for, you know, their entire childhood.
Tell me about your families.
Plural, family, yeah. Well, family's plural.
I'm thinking you had a son with Ursula.
Right.
And you have children with Lisa.
Right. My son Dimitri with Ursula. He's 43 now, and he's living in Rome right now, taking care of his mom, who's going through some health issues. He's a great kid. We get along great. He did not grow up with me, and that created some issues for him. Of course, any kid who grows up without a father around is going to have issues. It just goes without saying. So when Lisa was pregnant with our first daughter, with Delilah, I said to her, listen, you know, I'm going to avoid what happened with Dimitri, but I'm going to stay home. So don't let me go on location. I'm not going to leave town until they leave. And when we have an empty nest, then I'll go back to doing plays in New York. I'll go back to going on location for films, but until then, I said, I'm only going to work in LA. And that's how that worked out. And I was there for all of their school functions, for all their homework, for taking them to school every day and making their lunches and all that. I think that was really important.
Harry, where were you born?
Pasadena.
Oh, California. Really?
Yeah, I'm Californian.
Oh. We'll be back for more in a moment.
When I took the role on in L.A. Law, you know, I was very circumspect about it, and I said to Stephen Botchko, look, I'm going to do this, and I'm not going to do any press. I just want to do the work, and don't ask me to do any, I'm going to go 100% into the work.
People Magazine. You were the third sexiest man alive when they started doing those.
Yeah. That's
what kind of an impact did that have on you?
Really none whatsoever. But, you know, they had, when I first took on L.A. Law, I was not sure I wanted to do a TV series at all. I'd never done a TV series. I'd done a couple mini series, long form things, which were really great and really well written. I didn't really watch much TV. I'd never seen the shows that Stephen Botchko had done before, Hill Street Blues or whatever. I don't think I even owned a television back then, in fact. So when I took the role on in L.A. Law, you know, I was very circumspect about it. And I said to Stephen Botchko, look, I'm going to do this, and I'm not going to do any press. I just want to do the work, and don't ask me to do any, I'm going to go 100% into the work. I don't want to be distracted by anything. And I did that for the whole first season. And of course, people kept coming to me and wanting me to do press. And, you know, I kept saying, no, I'm not going to do it. And I got this reputation, I guess, in the first year for being like aloof or something like that. But I just wanted to concentrate on the work and make the show a success. So toward the end of the first season, they came to me and they said, and Stephen begged me to do three things. People Magazine, Us Magazine, and the Washington Post. You know, I turned and said no to all three of the things, and he just wouldn't leave me alone. And I finally said, okay, I'll do these interviews. And he said, oh, well, People Magazine's going to be a cover. And I went, oh, well, that's great, you know, whatever. I mean, and I shot it, and I talked to James Grant, who's remained a great friend of mine for all these years.
I know James.
Yeah, he wrote the article. I just got a nice text from him this morning, in fact. Not knowing that it was going to be that particular cover, because like you said, it was only the third time. No one knew it was going to be a thing, because it had happened twice, but no one knew it was going to go on for years and years and years and years. So I thought it was going to be a cover about, you know, L.A. Law. And then I was down in Australia doing a press tour for L.A. Law, and I was driving along in a limo along the street, and I looked over and I saw this billboard that said Sexiest Man Down Under. And then I, like, what does that mean? And then I looked up and I saw that this store had put like 100 magazine covers in the window, all of me. And I was mortified, absolutely mortified. And I looked at my watch, like, what time is it in Boston? Because my best friend lived in Cambridge. And I had to call him up and say, listen, I didn't know this was going to happen. You know, it's like, this was not planned. I was mortified. This is before people started making jokes about that and kind of embracing it. It was kind of mortifying.
Did you think it might make people think less of you?
I didn't really think about that, but yeah, I mean, look, that kind of thing doesn't exactly embellish one's artistic sensibility. You know, people think of you as like a piece of beefcake after something like that. You know, but it was what it was. I had to accept it. Right, acceptance is the biggest thing you can possibly come to in life. So I had to accept it.
So tell me about L.A. Law and how you came to accept working on a television show, which takes a lot of time, especially for a series.
Well, you know, the script came to me, and I didn't want to do a TV series, so I just tossed it down on a credenza somewhere. I didn't pay any attention to it for like a month. And then I had a friend of mine over for dinner, and he saw the script. He goes, oh, my God. You have the L.A. Law script? And I get, yeah, so what? He goes, but that's like, everyone wants to read that script. And I went, really? I haven't read it yet, you know, and I read it that night after dinner, and to this day, that pilot script remains the best thing I've ever read. I mean, it was perfectly written, that script. So I, and after reading, I went, wow, okay, I got to meet this guy. Whoever wrote this script, I got to meet him. Turns out it wasn't really written by Stephen Bochco. It was written by Tara Louise Fisher, who was his partner at the time. They collaborated on it, and she was sort of the law person involved. Stephen was not a law person, but I met him, and he offered me the part, but they couldn't afford my price. I turned it down, and I said, you know, I can't live on what you're offering me. The numbers don't work. You know, I have mortgages, child support payments. I've got car payments. I've got, and you add the numbers up, it just doesn't work. So I turned it down, and then my wife at the time, Laura Johnson, we were up visiting her parents on a weekend, and she just said, you know, it's really an opportunity you need to embrace somehow. Call Stephen back up and see if there's some way you can do it and make it work, which I did, and I went back and met him, and he said, listen, you know, you should do this, and it'll be great. And he's, the way TV series work is either they're hits or they're not. And if they're not a hit, they go away, in which case you'll go back to making your salary that you were making before. And if it's a big hit, then everyone's going to renegotiate their contracts. He said, I'll make more money. The studio will make more money. You'll make more money and all that. But then at the end of the first year, it was a huge hit. And yeah, that he didn't live up to that. But nevertheless, it ended up being a wonderful thing to do. For 5 years, but only for 5 years.
Tell me, in the vast scheme of the universe, what impact did it have on your career overall?
It beiged it out.
Beiged it out?
It beiged it. Yeah, before that, I was doing very interesting, different, weird roles. I was, you know, I'd done Summer and Smoke on Broadway with Frances McDormand, where I played a Hungarian Jew with one leg. You know, it was like a really interesting part that I was playing. I was playing a lot of interesting parts. Studs Lonergan was a really interesting part on television. And after doing 5 years of a TV series where you're wearing a tie and carrying a briefcase every day, people just see you in a certain way. And I stopped getting the opportunity to do those really interesting roles until now, when I'm getting back into them. So, I'm very pleased about where my career is at the moment.
Tell me where it is.
Well, Mayfair Witches, which is AMC's new project. They've moved away from The Walking Dead, and they've embraced Anne Rice's library. So they bought all of her work, and they put out Interview with the Vampire, Mayfair Witches, which is the show I'm doing, and now they're doing The Talamasca, which is the third Anne Rice edition. And the character that I play in this is delicious. Interesting. I'm really a character actor, and yet what L.A. Law did was sort of make me into sort of a beige leading man. So I'm back now, which is great.
Good. I'm going to have to remember that phrase. I like that. Beiged out my career. My producer tells me you are an avid hiker.
I am. As a matter of fact, I'm not supposed to be here today. I'm supposed to be driving up to the High Sierras to start a 3-day solo backpacking trip. This opened up today because I found out on Thursday, after getting everything ready, that the mountain I wanted to climb is on fire. The entire region is closed. So I don't know, I might have to wait until next year, or maybe I can do something in early October when I have a little bit of time to get back into that.
What do you get from hiking?
Well, you get into shape. What I get out of this 3-day thing that I do, 3-night, 4-day thing that I usually do solo, is I get to do a walkabout. I go for 3 days. It's a very, 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 very difficult hike. I did take one person with me once, and he made it. Had some difficulty getting through it, but he did make it. I've tried a couple other people who didn't make it and couldn't handle it, because it's I go places where goats can't even go without any trails. I go overland over mountain peaks and stuff, so it's an invigorating thing to do, and it's also solo, so I get to think. a lot while I'm walking or hiking.
And that helps you a lot?
Well, I mean, if we think about it, you know, when we're younger and we don't have so many obligations, it's much easier to take time to think and to just ruminate. When you get to older and you got all these different things pulling at you all the time, whether it's your career, your family, or whatever, is you have much less time to actually just allow your brain to ruminate. So a 3 or 4 day walkabout solo into the wilderness with no other humans, only animals, it's a good opportunity for that.
The more I read about aging, I'm discovering everybody is saying the same thing. You must keep moving at all costs. Keep moving to get all the organs functioning the way they're supposed to. And I do my best, but sometimes the couch wins.
Well, you want to try to get off the couch a little bit more, Steve. You know,
yes.
I mean, that's one of the reasons I hike on a daily, because I hike every day. Those are like mini hikes. I mean, when I do a major hike, I've got a 40-pound pack in my back. It's a different situation altogether. But the hikes that I do every day are for exactly that, for aging, because I'm 73 in a month, and it's like, okay, how can I be 73 and feel like I'm 25, which I feel like, you know? I attribute that to this oftentimes 3-mile hike every day. Sometimes I make it into a 2-mile hike instead of a 3-mile hike, but it's usually at least 2 miles, and I think it's an important thing to do.
We'll be back in a moment. What do you make of Hollywood after having been here for so long? What are your overall observations?
I have no idea. You know, last night I was at a thing called The Night Before, which happens the night before the Emmys, and I ran into Scott Berg, who wrote Making Love, and he and I had a long discussion about, like, the state of Hollywood today, and, you know, where it is, because, you know, I've known Scott since 1981, when we made this movie, and it's like, it's hard to tell, because it's changed 180 degrees from where it was when I started, and now with streaming, with, you know, there were 3 networks when I was working in television back in the day, and now there's, I don't know how many thousands there are, and you know, there's so much content, and this. We were Lisa and I were at another function for the Emmys on Friday night, and we were asked by the Hollywood Reporter, you know, what are you watching these days? What's your favorite show? And both of us looked at each other and was like, let's see. Because there's so many, and we're watching. It's hard to figure out one that stands out, you know. And I think that is a major change that Hollywood has taken on. I mean, it's like what? There's like 50 shows to watch at any given time, and all these different platforms to have to go on, and then you have all these strikes. I mean, I think this strike that we just had is like the 5th strike in my career. The first one was the 1980 actor's strike, when my career was just getting started, and it took all the wind out of those sails. And then there was another writer's strike, there was a director's strike, who knows, there was a commercial strike, there was all these different strikes. Now, every time there's a strike, the business suffers. And this last one, I mean, it may be close to a mortal blow.
Really?
Well, I mean, I think attendance in movies, I mean, look what's being made for the movies now. It's all comic stuff. I mean, I don't know, I mean, I don't go to the movies, I don't go out that much. I mean, the pandemic hurt that, then the strike hurt it more, and I think the business is, you know, is going through a huge, huge transition, and I hope it comes out on the other side okay.
Harry, I was reading something this morning about Michelle Williams, excellent actress, I think, and she was talking about the playing Marilyn Monroe in 2012, I think it was. My Week with Marilyn was the movie. And I believe she was Oscar nominated for it. But she got quite a bit of acclaim. But what really surprised me about the article was she was signed 2 years before they started production, which seemed like an awfully long time to me. And she says in the interview that it took her every minute of those 2 years to prepare for the part, because she wanted to do it justice. What lengths would you go to land a role you wanted?
Had she fought for that role?
Yes.
She had.
It's said that she was the only actress they considered. The writer of the film had her in mind for it. So I suppose that was working in her behalf. But she was talking about she wanted to fill out her figure a little bit to better represent Marilyn Monroe. She wanted the curves in the right places. And she said as she was doing that, her face started getting rounder, but not her hips. Oh. And so she gave that up for a while. But I think of some people who have gone to great lengths to Christian Bale comes to mind. He had a film role where he lost so much weight, it was almost hard to watch him on screen. Are you that dedicated to this profession that you would put yourself through? It's got to be tough.
No.
No?
Absolutely not. No, I would not mess with my health. You know, I think a lot of these people who've done that have ended up with serious consequences afterwards, physical consequences like diabetes and things like that. And I would not do that. No, I value my presence on the planet a lot more than I do getting an award of some kind. You know, the first film that I did was with George C. Scott, as I said, and he had turned down the Academy Award. And during the filming, he had admonished me about, wanting to go for awards and all of that stuff. So I never, for the first three or four things I did for television, I never put myself up for an Emmy. I believe in that. I don't believe in going after awards. I don't believe, if Christian Bale hadn't lost all that weight, I don't think if he'd lost a little bit, no one would have noticed that he didn't, I don't know. I really admire him as an actor, and I really admire people who will go down that road in order to do that. But it's such a gift to be alive and to be human and to be at this particular time living in this moment in human civilization that I would never give up a second of that for anything else or put myself in danger for anything like that.
Okay. I want to go back to the cooking show a little bit. How did the sauce come about?
When I was living in Rome with Ursula, when we were bringing up Dimitri, she's a great cook, by the way, and she gave me this recipe for making a spaghetti sauce, a bolognese sauce. It didn't include some of the ingredients that I have now, over the years, added to it. The base recipe came from her. And how to make it, because it's got to be made just right. The garlic has to be sautéed just right. If it's not done just perfectly, it doesn't taste the same, So over the years, I began to add different things to it. And now in this sauce here, there are only 8 ingredients, one of them being water, only a tiny, tiny amount of water. So there are really only 7 actual food ingredients in it. There's no preservatives, and it's completely natural. But I think the thing that really embellishes this sauce is that it's made with red wine and rosemary. And no other sauce that I've seen out there has those ingredients in it. And it makes it very, very distinct and very unusual, but also really good.
Yeah, I love rosemary. Where can people pick it up if they want to?
Well, at the moment, we just opened last week in a soft open at harrysfamous.com, which is our website. We've had tons of orders already. It's already out there in the zeitgeist. We do our official launch in October. Right now, it's all pre-orders for an October delivery. But hopefully, it'll be on Amazon within the next few months, and then We sent the sauce out to Whole Foods. They did an evaluation. They came back and they said, we love the sauce. We'd like to potentially have it in our stores, but we'd rather have more than one product, more than one SKU. So they like to, we're working on a second sauce, on a vodka sauce now. That's in R&D. And hopefully by this time next year, we'll have at least 3 different SKUs.
Are you having fun with this?
I am, yeah. I mean, my niece and I are doing it together, and we created a company called the Open Food Company in order to put the sauce out. And the Open Food Company is the first completely open source food company, in that we will put out not only the ingredients of everything we put out, but and we will have no preservatives, no chemicals, no additives in anything we put out, but we'll also give the recipe. So if somebody wants to make my sauce at home, they can go to the market, they can get the ingredients, and they can do it on the stovetop, or they can buy the sauce. And all the sauces will have the ingredients and the way to make it at home, because it's all going to be kitchen-made ingredients. And I think I love the idea of the open food company and an open source company that, I mean, we won't hide anything from anybody.
That's good. Your lovely wife, Lisa Rinna, was a longtime cast member of Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. And you popped up often.
Really? That often?
Were you
once in a while.
Were you comfortable playing yourself?
Yeah, no, I don't have any problem with that. No, I was there to support Lisa, and she made it through 8 years of that show, and in many ways she was a GOAT, greatest of all time. A lot of people think that she was the greatest housewife of all time. I know we ran into the head of the network last night at this event we were at, she kind of acknowledged that Lisa was missed on the show now that she's gone. I was there to support Lisa.
What was the hardest part of you and Lisa having so much of your lives exposed?
Well, there's really not anything hard about that to us at all. We're kind of an open book.
It's easier, isn't it, to be open about yourself?
Well, yeah. I mean, if you're not trying to hide anything, yeah, it's fine. And you know, we're proud of you know, the life we've created. I think maybe it's in some ways inspirational to some people, because we've been together for a long, long time. We've raised these kids, and the kids are all flourishing. So I think it's fine for us.
What do you do for fun, apart from hiking?
Well, you know, Lisa and I have a lot of fun together. We just enjoy our company together. Hiking is one thing. I mean, when I get a chance to scuba dive, that's one of my favorite things to do. We haven't had a chance to do that in a while. The pandemic kind of stopped a lot of the traveling that we have been doing, but we hope to get back to that soon. I don't play golf. I don't find that fun at all. I tried once. Not fun.
Me
for
too.
Me at all.
I tried once. Yeah. That was it.
Yeah.
I had a tension backache at the end of it.
Yeah. I mean, I had tendonitis all over my body from trying to hit the ball too much. And I lost a bunch of friends to golf, and I thought, you know what? I'm not going to waste my time with this, because, I mean, how many hours does it take to play 18 holes? I just don't have that time, because, you know, like I said, I've got a lot of different things that I like to do. I don't know if you know about my involvement with fusion energy or not, but it's
no.
That's been a huge part of my life for the last 40 years, I guess, and helped start a company that is the oldest privately funded fusion energy company in the world. And hopefully we will, within the next few years, crack that nut and be able to provide completely non-toxic electricity to the world forever, because that's the whole point.
Has anyone ever told you that you're a cerebral kind of guy? That's what you strike me as, very, very thoughtful, cerebral.
No one has ever said that.
Okay, well,
you're
wear
first.
It as a badge of honor. Not that I'm an authority. Thanks, Harry. Very appreciative of you coming in to sit down with us.
Yeah, absolutely. My pleasure, indeed. And it's good to see you. I've been following you for years. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Still Here Hollywood is a production of the Still Here Network. All things technical run by Justin Zangerly. Theme music by Brian Sanishin. And executive producer is Jim Lichtenstein.